Rockinitis.
Hi, cats and kittens. Welcome to Rockinitis. My name is Michael Willmore. My co-pilot here, Rob Frith, and I did a program on the Kinks earlier, and we didn't get through everything that we had to get through, so we're going to try to get through it now. Now, basically, we're going to stick with the material that the Kinks did under the production of Shel Talmy.
Yeah.
Now, Shel Talmy was an American guy who went over to England and had a kind of bogus letter of introduction or whatever,
yeah,
and somehow managed to become a producer of British groups.
Yeah, and British groups liked the idea of an American producer.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. And he produced the early Who, and what were some of the Creation?
Yeah.
And then he ran his own record label for a while, the Planet right. label. And he's kind of a legendary guy in the mythology and history of British rock from the 60s.
That's right.
Anyway, he produced everything that the Kinks did up to the Something Else album. Mm-hmm. And then after that, they produced themselves, or Ray Davies, leader of the Kinks, produced themselves.
That's right.
I've got a great photo here of Ray Davies in an English, in a Uncut magazine, which was out recently. This is the way Ray Davies looks now.
It's a great magazine, too.
Is it?
I get it every month.
Okay. There's a couple of other magazines out now.
Yeah, Mojo's.
Mojo's very good.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's the way Ray Davies looks now. And there's a great old picture by M. Livingstone, which is a picture that captures Ray Davies' persona perfectly, with him sniffing a rose like that and sipping a glass of wine. And if you had to describe Ray Davies' music or the music of the Kinks in a word, what would you think? What would you word would you use?
Oh, gee. That'd be tough.
Because I thought of a perfect word.
Yeah? What's that?
Sublime.
Sublime?
Yeah. He's got a wistful sound.
Well, it sounds kind of laid back, but he's also like, you know, he's also where he's different is he never worried about sounding English.
No, I think they flaunt their English.
Yeah, it seemed like it.
Yeah, like especially, you know, later on in the 70s when he got into that kind of showbizy sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And you say you saw him. I saw him in the 70s with the Kinks at Exhibition Gardens.
Yeah,
you say you were at that show?
Yeah, I was at that show too.
How come I didn't see you there?
I know. Well, and then later seeing that Storyteller concert that he did.
Oh, I never saw that. Okay.
That was absolutely fabulous. I think you can actually buy it on CD, the actual mm-hmm. performance. And it was the most, it's one of my top concerts of all time, because he would tell these great stories, then play a couple of tunes, mm-hmm. then tell stories again. And it got to a point where the stories were so interesting, you couldn't wait for the songs to be over, so he'd start talking again.
Oh, yeah, he was that charming.
The most, yeah, it was just the most magical concert I've ever seen.
Well, I don't usually do this, but after the Kinks concert, it was such a great concert, and it ended a little early, like it ended around 11:30 or something. Yeah. Anyway, I didn't really want to go off home, and it was in the middle of the winter.
Right.
And this would have been about, what, about 75?
No, 70.
Oh, 70.
1970.
Okay, well, that was the one at Exhibition Gardens? It was that early, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was that
early. Oh, okay.
It was basically their first touring back after they've been banned from touring.
Okay, yeah, because
they started, I think, in 69 well, touring again, and then they just continued to make up all that lost money and continued to tour, like, you know, and so I think by the time they got to Canada, it was 1970.
Because the Davies brothers used to get into punch-ups on stage. They used to get into actual fistfights on stage. And Dave Davies had to get 10 stitches in his scalp after the drummer, Mick Avery, hit him over the head with a cymbal.
Well, apparently he threw it like a frisbee, apparently.
Oh, wow. Sliced his hair, piece off. Anyway, this was at a concert in Cardiff, Wales in 1965, and the Walker brothers had to fill in for the Kinks for the rest of the tour. And also, they were banned later for fighting in the U.S.
That's right.
And they were banned for like 4 years, right at the peak of their career.
Yeah, it was just, they were so big at that point. Mm-hmm. It just, I mean, the money they lost would have been just incredible by not being able to complete that tour.
Okay, now this is one of my favorite albums by the Kinks, even though most of the stuff on it is available elsewhere. Their labels were, like in England, they were on the Pye label, and in America, they were on the Reprise record label. This song here, 1965, Till the End of the Day, it made number 8 in England. And this was the first song I played one Sunday morning when I got up, looked out the window and it was raining. Mm-hmm. And I looked out the window and I put this song on, and it just basically made my whole day.
Baby, I feel good from the moment I rise. Feel good from morning to the end of the day. To the end of the day. You and me, we live this life. When we get up to the music.
Now that song, as well as being on the Greatest Hits album, was also included on the Kinks Kingdom LP, another great cover from the Kinks. And Rob was just saying to me off air there about how virtually every song by the Kinks from this period was phenomenal.
Oh, yeah.
They just wrote some wonderful stuff.
Even the songs that weren't hits, I mean, they seem like they should be. In fact, to me, they seem like they are because I played them so often.
Yeah, you
played
them so much.
I can never remember if I heard them on the radio or I played them at home.
With that time so strongly.
Yeah.
And you sort of figure they were hits even though you didn't actually get radio play.
That's right.
Yeah. Anyway, this one here, this is from the Kinks Controversy LP. Another great cover. And well, here, Where Have All the Good Times Gone? This came out on the Pye record label, 1965. Another great tune by the Kinks.
Well, live my life and never stop to worry about a thing. Open up and shout it out and never try to sing. Wondering if I've done wrong. Will this depression last for long? Won't you tell me, where have all the good times gone? Where have all the good times gone? Thank you.
Now that song, it almost seems like a Kinks song, but actually it's a real oldie. It was first done by Kokomo Arnold, a black blues artist, back in 1929.
Wow.
Then it was cut by Elvis, and Johnny Wills did a version of it. So it's a kind of a country and western and blues standard by the time that the Kinks got around to it.
They give it a real garage sound.
Yeah, the thing I like about them, they got this chunky sound.
Yeah.
Like everything sounds chunky. And there's all these kinds of stops and starts in the music. And yet there's a kind of a flow to it as well, this kind of wistful flow.
Yeah.
Anyway, love them.
Oh, yeah. I mean, just...
Now, show some of that stuff you got piled up there. There's a book there by Ray Davies.
This book here, I mean, if anyone likes the Kinks, you've got to have this book, X-Ray by Ray Davies.
Now, I've got this book, and it's been sitting by my bed for about 2 years.
Yeah.
And I've never had time to read it.
I read it when it first came out, and it was just, I couldn't put it down. And then, knowing I was going to do this show, there was a couple of facts I wanted to look up, and I was going through it, and I started reading it again. I'm enjoying it even more the second time. It's just a fabulous book.
No, the guy's a great storyteller and a great writer, and a very talented man.
Yeah, I brought a few other little things,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, let's see what you got there.
Well-respected man, the sheet music for that.
Mm-hmm.
And... Tired of Waiting for You by the sheet music, which apparently was written on his way to the studio.
Oh, really?
Like, he'd sort of had little bits and pieces, but basically finished it at the studio, and because they wanted the next single.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's kind of his earlier sort of writing, at times writing, and then he became a totally prolific writer, and just, you know, just stuff just flowed out of
him. What I like is that a lot of his stuff, particularly the later stuff, is kind of little vignettes of life in England.
Yeah.
And they're kind of philosophical, kind of little turns of phrases, things. And it's, more than any other group, they flaunt their Englishness.
Oh, yeah, totally.
And there's, like, you know, you think of a song like Dedicated Follower of Fashion. I mean, he sings that line where he's almost like he's sniffing snuff.
Yeah.
Like an old Englishman, right? He goes, he's a dedicated follower of fashion.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like that. It's English, right?
Yeah.
They flaunt it.
It's funny, you know, he was always very self-conscious about the gap in his teeth.
Right.
And the very beginning, the management said, you can't go on stage like that. You don't look professional. You got to get it fixed. So they made an appointment for the dentist, and he went to the dentist. And he said, well, what are you going to do? And he said, well, we're going to grind these down and put these, you know, caps on. And he just jumped out of the chair and ran out and phoned the management and said, you know, I can't do that. Mm-hmm. So anyway, they had to go on Ready, Steady, Go. So they stuck these fake caps on. And they said he looked like a rabbit. He just had these giant teeth. And apparently it's on film somewhere, but he said he's glad he never did it. It always bothered me.
Yeah, it's a trademark,
younger.
Anyway.
It's a trademark.
Having a gap between your teeth.
And he said when he ran into...
becomes a trademark.
Oh, what's her name from the... Martha Reeves, from Martha Reeves of the Vandellas. Mm-hmm. He said it was the best thing that ever happened to him because she had even a bigger gap in her teeth. And he said he didn't feel so bad after that.
Anyway, we ended up being at the same show, even though I don't think we knew each other.
No, we didn't.
But after the show, I don't think I finished the story I was telling about it. After the show, it was pouring rain. It was the middle of the winter.
Yeah, that's right.
Freezing cold.
It was November.
Yeah, it was November or something like that. Anyway, we went out to the backstage door to watch the Kinks come out and get into their limo. And so there was this other group that had been on as a warm-up act called the Babies or something like that.
Oh,
anyway, they came out, and anyway, there was four or five groupie girls that were standing around, and it was freezing cold, right? And every time somebody had come out of the door, they'd immediately open their coats like this and stand like that so you could see their cleavage and stuff. And it was very comical. Anyway, I said, wait a minute, what are we doing standing here with these groupies? I feel silly. What are we going to do when the Kinks come out? And my girlfriend said, well, let's get their autographs. Oh, right. Autographs, I thought. That's what we're doing here.
Yeah.
So I found a little piece of paper, and I handed it to her. So I said, well, when he comes out, you step forward and say, would you please give me an autograph, Mr. Davies? So she goes, okay. So just then, the door opens, and the Kinks come out. And the first couple of them come out and get in the back of the limo, and there's a pause. Then Ray Davies comes out with a woman. So my girlfriend steps forward with this piece of paper and goes, would you, like, and then he bumps into her. She drops a piece of paper. He steps on the paper and gets into the limo. So I pick up the paper, and there's a perfect print of his heel print. A perfect image of his heel print on the piece of paper. So I saved it for several days.
Those kinky boots.
Yep. Anyway, we're going to go now to Sunny Afternoon.
Oh, that's
one which of my is one of my favorite songs of all time. And it displaced the Beatles' Paperback Writer. Knocked it right off the charts.
You know, it's reminiscent of Beach Boys tunes for summer. Mm-hmm. That song, I mean, it's just perfect summer.
Well, the Kinks
song.
Did a lot of songs about the weather.
Yeah.
Like Rainy Day in June and songs like that. And that's actually the tune we're going to follow with. Now, Rainy Day in June, it's got wonderful lyrics. They're kind of childlike, mm-hmm. kind of like children's story time.
Right.
But on another level, it could be apocalyptic, like about the end of the world. Because it goes, the demon stretched its wrinkled head and snatched the butterfly. The elves and gnomes were hunched in fear, too terrified to cry. The reckoning was beckoning. They're living to their doom. There was no hope, no reasoning, this rainy day in June. So it's kind of like the Dylan song, It's a Hard Rain's Gonna Fall,
yeah,
or something like that.
Well, he's a pretty dark guy. He's always been he's afraid of dying. He's always been afraid of dying.
Well,
ever since
isn't?
He was a little kid. Yeah, but some people even more. They say that's a sign of genius in kids.
Oh, yeah.
When they're thinking about dying rather than playing with cars and things like that.
Okay.
So they're like deep thinkers. So
well, he's definitely a musical genius. Yeah. And well, first of all here, Sunny Afternoon, which made number one in England. And this is from the Face-to-Face LP, which made number 12 on the UK album charts. The Kinks with Sunny Afternoon.
Sail my yacht. He's taken everything I got. All I've got's this sunny afternoon.
That was the Kinks with a couple of tunes from a wonderful LP, which made number 12 on the UK LP charts in 1966 on the Pye record label. Sunny Afternoon and Rainy Day in June. And we're going to play a single tune off the very last album produced by Shel Talmy. The Something Else LP, 1967, Waterloo Sunset. Now, if you've ever been to London, there's a station for the underground train called Waterloo Station.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what this song is about. It's about standing at the Waterloo Station and looking at the English sunset. Now, I did this exact same thing. I remember being at Waterloo Station, seeing the sunset, which you could see over the buildings.
So did you wait there all day?
No, I didn't wait there all day for the sunset, but I happened to be there at that time. Yeah. Anyway, I went and did whatever it was I did, and then I came back later, and you had to catch the last train, the last train in the tube, by a specific time, mm-hmm. in order to, because then they locked the gates, right?
Right.
So the pubs close, at that time, they close like at 10, and the last train leaves at 10:30. So you have to get to the station. They got it all figured so that they clear the streets, basically, by the appropriate time. So anyway, all the couples in the area that had been on dates, they don't have a car culture like we do, they didn't then. So, you know, there's no place to neck. So they would go to Waterloo Station with their date. They'd be saying goodbye after the play or the movie or whatever they were doing.
Right.
And so they'd have a kiss goodnight. This train hasn't arrived yet, so then they'd have another kiss goodnight. Anyway, they ended up, a lot of them, really getting into it. So I'm standing there waiting for the train, and there's like 15 couples all over the place necking up a storm. And some of them are really getting into it.
Yeah.
You know, you're trying not to look. You're kind of averting your eyes and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, the lyrics on this song are kind of about that. It says, Terry meets Julie, Waterloo Station, every Friday night. But I am so lazy, I don't want to wander. I stay home at night. But I don't feel afraid. As long as I gaze on Waterloo sunset, I am in paradise. So it's kind of like being at Waterloo Station and all that. Great tune. By the Kinks, Waterloo Sunset.
Terry meets Julie, Waterloo Station, every Friday night. But I am so lazy, don't want to wander. Sunset, I am in paradise. Every day I look at the world on my window. Chilly, chilly is the evening time. Waterloo sunset's fine.
So that tune made number two in England in 1967. Was a really big hit for them there. I don't recall ever hearing
it. No, I don't think it ever got airplay.
They had a lot of songs. They were always, you know, in their mythology, they always talk about how the Kinks were far bigger in America than they ever were in England. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the, you know, the hard copy from the charts for those days, the Kinks always did better in England than they did here. Because so many things they had that were big hits there were never even played here.
That's true. But I think they probably had more hits in Canada than they did in the United States.
Because of the English connection, I guess. We're going to end off this look at the Kinks from Lola, which is one of their biggest hits. Yeah. And if you could just hold that in place. This is a great double LP that has Lola on it, among a bunch of other things that kind of chronicle the Kinks, an overview of the Kinks' career from beginning to end. Now, I bought this on the original single when it came out in 1970, and I heard it on the car radio. I was going camping with my girlfriend, and we were driving up this real steep slope with a road that was half of it was washed away by a river.
Oh, yeah.
And it was really a rough road, and the car was bouncing all over the place, and my girlfriend was asleep, and it was like 11 o'clock at night, and the guy said, here's the new one by the Kinks, and they haven't had a hit since 1966 with Sunny Afternoon. Mm-hmm. And maybe this one is the one that'll do it for them, is what he said. And he played Lola, and I heard it for the very first time, and it always stuck in my mind. Halfway through the song, I guessed what it was about.
Yeah.
Like nobody else, they seemed to have to have heard it several times before they figured it.
I figured it right away too.
Don't get.
But it's interesting, they actually flew Ray from London to New York. I guess they must have recorded that one in New York, mm-hmm. or something. And they flew him there to change the lyric, one lyric.
Oh, he had the lyrics
Coca-Cola.
Cherry Cola.
Yeah.
Originally.
Yeah.
And they changed it to Coca-Cola. No, it was the other way around.
Yeah.
Right. It was Coca-Cola.
They couldn't use a brand name.
And it was a trademark name that Coca-Cola wouldn't have liked them using. They changed it to Cherry.
So they flew them all the way to New York just to change one line.
Anyway, the opening riff, when I saw the Kinks live that time, this is the song that they started off the show with, but he just played that jung, 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 you know, and everybody went, whoa! And then he went into another song.
Yeah.
Right? But then he did do it later. Anyway, an immortal classic, and the B-side is Berkeley Muse, the Kinks.
I met her in the club down in Old Soho, where you drink champagne and it tastes just like cherry cola, C-O-L-A cola. She walked up to me and she asked me to dance. I asked her her name and in a dark brown voice she said Lola, L-O-L-A, Lola, 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 Lola. Well, I'm not the world's most physical guy, but once you squeeze me tight, you need to grow. I thought you had much better.
Now, Berkeley Muse is the flip side of Lola, and in its own way, it's a totally charming song, almost as good as Lola itself. Thanks very much for being here, Rob.
Thanks again.
I enjoyed myself.
That's great.
Second look at the Kinks.
Rockinitis.
I've been told that the rockin' eye